Here we are, my friends. Here we are. We are live. It's a Thursday night. It's September. It's been far too long since I've seen all your lovely chat messages in the chat area, which is right over there. Be sure to say hello. My name is George Hrab. This is episode 29 of Seven Songs. And our theme today is James Bond, hence the subtle outfit. The very subtle. I was debating, is it too obvious? Is it too obvious to wear a tux? No, I think we're good. I think we're good. That's not that it's a tux necessarily, but to evoke a tuxedo, I thought, why not? Why not? It's been a while, and the songs deserve it. So we're going to go through a bunch of really fun tunes. We've got seven songs, all that were James Bond themes. I have a fact sheet here, which is very exciting, with all of the James Bond songs, and it's pretty amazing. There's, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25. There's 25 movies. The 25th movie's not out yet, but there are 25 movies that are in the can. But there's only 23 songs, actually, because the first two films didn't have a song. I'm going to dive right in. We're going to talk about what makes a James Bond song a James Bond song. Are there themes? Are there tropes? Is there harmonic action which is happening within the thing? And I figured the best way to start this, again, let us know in the chat there if everything is okay or if everything is not okay. Still using our gear here. We're just trying to get used to it and make sure that it's all happy snappy. Song number one is in many ways from the quintessential James Bond movie. It's the third film in the franchise, and this was kind of the first real James Bond song, because the two movies before, Dr. No was the first film, and then after that was From Russia with Love, and those didn't really have songs. Dr. No had like a Three Blind Mice Calypso thing, which wasn't really the James Bond theme. From Russia with Love, there was like an instrumental sort of thing that was combined with the James Bond theme, so there wasn't really a song. Goldfinger, 1964, the third James Bond movie, was the first real James Bond specially written theme song. And within it, it contains pretty much all of the tropes that would be used for the next 55 years. Starting with the very first chord motion, which is these two chords. It's an F and a D flat. And they're both major chords. And right away that sets up this tension, this James Bond tension. It's amazing. We're going to come back to this interval and these chords throughout the entire canon of the James Bond songs. What's happening? I don't even know what key this song is in. It's so strange what happens in terms of this, in terms of the key center. But if we were in F, that D flat is out of the key. It shouldn't be in there, and it shouldn't be a major chord. So right away it sets up, it's two major chords that are a third apart. It's very strange, very strange. And that happens later all over. I'm going to play through this, and then we're going to dissect it afterwards. I'm going to show you one interesting thing that happened. This was Shirley Bassey sang this. It was her biggest hit. And it kind of inserted itself into the culture. The Simpsons used it when they did Mr. Scorpio. Scorpio, it's totally a Goldfinger thing. Life of Brian, the theme from Life of Brian is basically kind of a Goldfinger-esque song, which is really amazing. And the neatest thing is at the end of the song, Shirley Bassey holds this note. He only loves gold! And she holds this. And this is what Vic Flick, who was a session musician, he played guitar, he said this. Originally, Shirley Bassey struggled with the song and that final long note. Barry, who was the producer, said, "Do it again." And she said she couldn't do it. But there was this rustling noise. So she was singing in the booth. She couldn't do it. She's trying. She said, "Wait a second." There was a rustling noise, and suddenly a bra came over the top of the vocal booth. She took off her bra and she hit the last note. She just let it fly. So picture yourself for the rest of your life when you hear that last note, a braless Shirley Bassey. There's fewer happier images one could probably have in one's head singing Goldfinger. Here we go. the man with the Midas touch, a spider's touch. Such a cold finger beckons you to enter his web of sin. But don't go in. Golden words he will pour in your ear, but his lies can't disguise what you fear. For a golden girl knows when he's kissed her. It's the kiss of death from Mr. Goldfinger. Pretty girl, beware of his heart of gold. His heart is cold. Golden words he will pour in your ear, but his lies can't disguise what you fear. For a golden girl knows when he's kissed her. It's the kiss of death from Mr. Goldfinger. Pretty girl, beware of his heart of gold. He only loves gold. Okay, so within this, you hear the James Bond theme chord progression. Right? And that's a really, it's just a minor chord. It's a minor one chord, or an A minor for this example. Right? And you take the fifth, and you go up a half step, and then another half step. And it's this tension. It's this lovely tension that's built. It's very simple. So that's in here. That ends up being in the song Thunderball. They use that same motif, and that motif appears again and again. Now, here's what's fascinating about this. When Anthony Newley wrote the lyrics, John Barry wrote the music, and when John Barry came to the producer and played it for the first time, the guy said, "That's just Moon River." So check this out. If you do those opening chords to Goldfinger, right? Right? Goldfinger, which is the F and the D flat major chord. Goldfinger. But if you do this, Moon River, wider than a mile, I'm crossing you in style someday. It's Moon River, but with different chords. Moon River. Again, Moon River. It's a D minor 7 instead of a D flat major chord. Totally changes the character of it. But Moon Goldfinger, wider than a mile. It's so interesting. And he was like, nah, change the chords. It's fine. It's fine. Just that first line. Moon River Goldfinger. Amazing what you can do with orchestration, huh? Love it. What else is there? Was that it? That's it. Yes. Okay. Moving on. Oh, by the way, cheers, everybody. I hope you're all safe and dry and happy. And I don't want to dwell on this. Actually, let's go over here if we can. I don't want to dwell on this, but for those of you keeping score, guess who's playing across the street at the Twisted Olive right now? I can hear them right now. Maybe you can hear them a little bit now, but yeah, guess who's playing across the street? That's right. My music fest friends. I don't even want to say that band name, but the band whose initial is SS are playing, which is appropriate, are playing right across the street, which is perfect. I had no idea they'd be there. So those, I don't want to dwell, but that's what's happening right in earshot. So it's perfect. It's perfect. So I'm glad I'm here with you. Our next tune goes to 1981, the movie For Your Eyes Only, and it's Sheena Easton singing For Your Eyes Only. Now, there's sort of the main two kinds of James Bond songs that there are songs that use the movie's title and songs that don't use the movie's title. So the Goldfinger obviously uses the movie's title. For Your Eyes Only uses the movie's title as well. Sheena Easton, this was the 12th movie. Sheena Easton is the only person in any James Bond film that you can see them singing the theme as it's being played. So there's other characters and stuff. Now Madonna sang The World Is Not Enough. Is that the one she sang? No. Sorry, Madonna sang Die Another Day, and she's in the movie. She plays a fencing instructor, but she doesn't sing in the opening credits. Sheena Easton, who was only 22 at the time, she was 22 years old, and she sings in the opening credits because the producers thought, hey, let's put Sheena Easton in there. She'll sing, and we'll have the whole thing going on. Sheena Easton was the youngest person to sing a James Bond theme until Billie Eilish, who, for the newest one, for No Time to Die, she was only 18. So she now holds the record for youngest James Bond singer. So here it is. Let's see. Blondie was offered this tune. Debbie Harry was like, no, I don't, no thanks. They like, can we write our own? So they were like, all right, write your own. And they ended up writing a song, and the producers didn't like the song they wrote. But they ended up using that song on their 1982 album, The Hunter. I don't know what the song is. I can't find what the song is. Unless it's called For Your Eyes Only, but I'm not sure. But Debbie Harry's like, no, that song is too complacent and too submissive, she said. It's too submissive in nature. I'm not going to sing that. Bill Conti, the orchestra arranger, wanted Barbara Streisand to write the lyrics, and he wanted Donna Summer to sing it. But Streisand was working on the film Yentl, so she couldn't do it. Here it is from 1981. This song does not have many Bond tropes in it. It's a pretty straightforward song. The thing that's interesting about it is it's crazy high. It's actually the span of the song is almost more than two octaves, which is really interesting. This is from 1981. This hit number 8 in the UK and was number 4 on the US charts, which is interesting. Goldfinger, by the way, was 21 in the UK and number 8 in the US. So this performed better than Goldfinger. Go figure. And it's not that iconic of a song. So let's just do this. Here we go.
No one else can see. Now I'm breaking free for your eyes.
again, not the James Bondiest kind of tune, but it's all right. It's all right. It's fun to sing. And again, the range is really big because it goes all the way from this that low G. So it's got a high D, so it's like an octave and a half, which is big for a song. So, what's that? Oh yeah, my gosh. Zipping along, that was number two. Our next tune keeps us in the 80s. And this is my favorite James Bond song. And this is the only James Bond song to reach number one in the United States. It was number two in the UK, but no other James Bond song has reached number one in the US apart from this one. Any guesses? Can you guess what this one is? You would think it's the one, but it's not. It's this. It's Duran Duran's A View to a Kill. Yeah. No, I'm sorry. Billie Eilish now has had the number one in the US as well. So the latest Billie Eilish, she was number two in the UK, number one in the US. This was number one in the US and number two in the UK, A View to a Kill, from 1985. The bassist John Taylor was friends with Cubby Broccoli, who's the producer for the Bond films. They were both drunk at a party, and John Taylor said, like, your tunes have not been great in the James Bond movies recently. What can we do about it? And Cubby said, well, write something and we'll talk. So they ended up writing this. They performed it at Live Aid in Philadelphia back in 85. I remember watching that at my cousin's house, which was very exciting. Yeah, and this song also is another strange, but it has sort of the tropes in there because there's some motion. So it's this dramatic, we have a lot of chords being built up over a C pedal. Pedal meaning just a note that's a chord that's sustained. So the intro is the C minor over C, G over C, C minor 7 over C, F over C. And then we're in the verse, C minor, right? And then all of a sudden, we go into the chorus, which is sort of an E, but the chords are just bopping all over the place. So I'm gonna listen for the, yeah. So we're in C minor. Sorry, my brain is all frazzled. Meeting you with a view to a kill. That's where we are for the verses, and then the second half of the verse, the chords change. Nightfall covers me, but you know the plans I'm making. We're not over a C pedal anymore. And then stay overseas. Could it be the whole lot opening wide? And now we're in A. Now what just happened? Well, we did this sort of up a third, that James Bond third chords. Really interesting, really interesting. And then we get into the chorus. Dance into the fire. Fatal guess is all we need. Now we're in E, sort of. Dance into the fire. So we've gone from C minor to sort of a A flat to E. It's just all over the place, but it totally works, and that's a very Duran Duran thing. They like their block chord motion. So from 85, the one of two James Bond songs to go to number one in the US, this is View to a Kill.
You know the plans I'm making. Stay overseas.
such a fun tune. It's neat when you watch the video from 85, which is a very cheeky kind of fun. They insert themselves into the View to a Kill Eiffel Tower chase sequence. But you see the band is kind of split up the way it's going to go. The three guys that ended up doing Arcadia are kind of together, and the guys that ended up doing Power Station are kind of together. And it's interesting that soon thereafter they took a break, and those two bands, the Duran Duran, formed those two sub bands, Power Station and Arcadia. Power Station, which is a wonderful, that first record is absolutely fantastic. Yeah, there it is. View to a Kill. Next tune, we go to Shirley Bassey again. Shirley Bassey sang three James Bond songs. Goldfinger, which we did. Diamonds Are Forever, which we're not going to do. So apologies for those of you that are fans of Diamonds Are Forever. And this song, this is from 1979. This is when James Bond was trying to cash in on Star Wars. That's right, Moonraker. Moonraker. Somewhat agreed that this is kind of the least James Bondian James Bond film that there is. There's a certain amount of style to it, but it's quite silly because there's space battles in it. That's right, space battles. I went and saw this with my dad and sister, and my dad had explained to me that there are no space stations happening right now. Like, because I was like, there's no space stations, right? He's like, no, there's no space stations. That's not true. He was not pleased with this particular film, the laser battle around the space station. Instead of an empty volcano, they're basically on a space station fighting. So, but the Kate Bush was originally asked to do this, and she didn't want to. So Kate Bush said no. Then Johnny Mathis was supposed to sing it, and Johnny Mathis said, "I don't want to sing it either." So they went to Shirley Bassey. They said, "Shirley, you've done a couple of these. Can you do another one?" And she said, "Sure." It was a very quick recording, very quickly done. Again, not the greatest tune, and it's a very hard challenge, but it is a song that does feature the title, Moonraker. I mean, write a song with the word Moonraker, not only in it, but that's the title. Good luck. 1979. This happens to be Maynard's favorite James Bond song. I think it's his favorite. So this is going out to Maynard, if he watches this eventually. My favorite Australian radio person of all time. No contest. Here it is. It's lovely. And there's a wonderful, cringy, but wonderful disco version that happens at the end of the credits of the film, because disco, of course, it's 1979, so whatever disco's going to do, they've already done, and it's like 2 years past disco's prime, so of course they had to include the disco version of Moonraker, which is just wonderful. So here it is, Shirley Bassey's 1979. How did she do on the charts with this? Nothing. It didn't chart at all. No charting. UK or US, which, yeah. But I like it because Maynard likes it, and I've fallen in love with it. Like the Moonraker goes in search of his dreams of gold, I search for love, for someone to have and hold. I've seen your smile in a thousand dreams. Thank you. just like the Moonraker knows. His dreams will come true someday. I know that you're only a kiss away. I've seen your smile in a thousand dreams. Felt your touch. Now, what's neat here is they're using one of the Bond tropes, but they've modified it a little bit. So it's a B to E minor, right? So B, major chord, to E minor. But E minor is the relative minor of G, G major. So it's that, it's the Goldfinger chords, right? But with a different bass note. So it's, really neat that it's like it's baked in there. It's baked in the and it's a Shirley Bassey song also, which is kind of fun. So where are you? Why do you hide? It would work. It would be kind of funky. Why do you hide? But do the minor, E minor. So it's neat. It's a little hidden trope in there. Otherwise, it's much more a straightforward pop tune. And again, if you can find the disco version on YouTube, please listen to it because it'll make you smile in ways that are really lovely. As ever, I have my Venmo and my PayPal over here. If you can, George-Hrab on Venmo and george@georgehrab.com over there on the PayPal. If you could do that. Let's take a second to talk about some of the other movies and other songs. Like I said, there's 25 of these guys. Dr. No had no song. From Russia with Love had no song. Goldfinger had Goldfinger. Thunderball had Thunderball. You Only Live Twice was a song by Nancy Sinatra. That was number 11 in the U.S., which is the U.K., 44 in the U.S. What's cool is in the film On Her Majesty's Secret Service, which is a George Lazenby, that's the only film that George Lazenby did as James Bond, there was no like official song. But Louis Armstrong sang We Have All the Time in the World, which is kind of like the James Bond theme song for that movie, but not quite. It's really interesting. Diamonds Are Forever, Shirley Bassey, like I said. Live and Let Die from 73, Paul McCartney and Wings. Man with the Golden Gun, Lulu sang a song called The Man with the Golden Gun. Can you think of how that song goes? I can't think of it either, and it didn't chart on either side of the ocean. Spy Who Loved Me, nobody does it better. Carly Simon, that was number 7 and number 2. Moonraker, Shirley Bassey, did not chart. For Your Eyes Only, Sheena Easton. Now, Octopussy. Wouldn't you, if you had the opportunity to write a song called Octopussy, you would take it, but no. It was Rita Coolidge and All Time High, which was number 75 in the UK, number 36 in the US. View to a Kill, which we just did. Living Daylights by the band A-ha. It's really fun to see who is culturally relevant within the context of the James Bond film song and who remains so. I mean, Lulu was the shit in 1974. Sheena Easton, who's wonderful. I love her. Rita Coolidge? Okay. Duran Duran, fine. A-ha, okay, interesting. License to Kill. Gladys Knight sings License to Kill in 1989. It was number 6 in the UK, did not chart in the US. Goldeneye from 1995. Tina Turner sang that, but it was written by Bono and The Edge from U2. Tomorrow Never Dies was Sheryl Crow. The World Is Not Enough, that was Garbage. The band Garbage did a James Bond song. I didn't remember that. Die Another Day was Madonna. Casino Royale, You Know My Name by Chris Cornell. Quantum of Solace is a song called Another Way to Die by Jack White and Alicia Keys. Skyfall by Adele, huge hit for her, number 2 in the UK, number 8 in the US. Spectre, Writings on the Wall by Sam Smith, that was a big hit as well, and number 1 in the UK. And Billie Eilish, No Time to Die. No Time to Die, number 1 in the US, number 16 in the UK. Yeah. Oh, so she didn't have a number 1. I'm all confused. She did not have a number 1. She had a number 1 in the UK. Regardless, we're going to move on to what many people think is the best James Bond song. I could argue that it is, because it encompasses all of the things that sort of James Bond song should have in it. There's a ballad section, there's a fast section, there's like a secondary section, a contemplative section, and then it's just a cool riff, and it's Paul McCartney and Wings' Live and Let Die. Apparently Paul McCartney wrote this in like 10 minutes, which is insane. But the original drummer for Wings, he said this. Paul told us, he said a couple weeks before we did the actual recording, he said he wanted to write a theme to the next James Bond movie, and they sent him the book to read. We were up at the house one day, and he had just read the book the night before. He sat down at the piano and said, James Bond, da-da-dum, and he started screwing around at the piano. Within 10 minutes, he had the song written. It was awesome, really. Just to watch him get in there and write the song was really something I'll remember the rest of my life. McCartney said, I'll write it, but I have to perform it. And my band Wings has to play it as well. George Martin produced it, which was great. And this, in 2012, to coincide with the 50th anniversary of Dr. No, was voted the number one Bond theme in a BBC Radio 2 poll. So the runners-up were Goldfinger and Nobody Does It Better. So it's got this reggae section in the middle, it's got the ballad section, and it's got the great, great riff. It was redone by Guns N' Roses, and here it is from 1973. This is Live and Let Die. When you were young and your heart was an open book, you used to say, live and let live. You know you did, you know you did, you know you did. In this ever-changing world in which we're living, makes you give in and cry. So live and let die. Live and let die. Live and let die. Live and let die. Thank you. on an E flat. We've been in G the whole time. We've been in G minor and major, and it ends on an E flat and leads into the opening sequence. So this was Roger Moore's first outing as James Bond, replacing Sean Connery, who had replaced George Lazenby, who had replaced Sean Connery. And this tune is neat because it's got these diminished chords. So you got this, you know you did, G, B minor, C, D, D flat 9, you know you did, and then the, just really, it's simple, and obviously it all works within the context of the piano. So I'm just trying to picture like Paul McCartney sitting at a piano writing this thing and people just sitting watching, and it must have been sickly magical to watch that happen. So wonderful orchestration in there. Like I said, George Martin was the producer for it, so he had done the orchestration. And this whole, it's just neat. And I gotta say, the Guns N' Roses version was pretty cool as well. So, okay. Now this is a song, the next one is one that I've done a bunch of times, but I just really enjoy this a lot. Let's go over here, actually. This is from 1977. Carly Simon, the movie is The Spy Who Loved Me, and this was actually the first James Bond theme that didn't have the movie title in it. And it's called Nobody Does It Better. It's from The Spy Who Loved Me. And Marvin Hamlisch and Carol Bayer Sager wrote this song, which is really cool. What's the thing here? Yeah, I get, well, okay. So the Louis Armstrong song, We Have All the Time in the World, wasn't officially called whatever that was from Majesty's Secret Service, but that wasn't an official tune. So this officially is the first official James Bond song that doesn't have the name of the movie in the thing. Fine. Roger Moore says this is his favorite one. And what's really cool about this particular tune, the way it's used, and the kind of the relief that it provides, because the opening sequence of this particular James Bond movie has arguably the greatest opening stunt of any James Bond film. I don't know if you remember, but Bond is up in the mountains somewhere. He's romancing a woman, of course. He gets the call. He has to go leave. The woman talks into her vodka bottle or whatever. She calls a bunch of thugs to go attack James Bond. They go. It's a big ski chase with some horrible blue screen, but still, it's a really nice ski chase. And then James Bond, of course, skis off of a cliff, right? He's being chased by these guys. He skis off of a cliff, and it's a single shot. It's an unbelievably dangerous stunt that was done for real, no, obviously before CGI, an actual stuntman skied off of a cliff. He's falling. It's a single camera shot. He drops his poles. He drops his skis, and a parachute opens. And you don't even realize that Bond has a parachute the entire time as he's like leaving the thing. So the parachute opens. It's got the Union Jack on it. The James Bond theme kicks, right? And it's just the whole da-da-da-da-da, you know, the whole James Bond thing. That kind of dissolves, and as he's floating down with the parachute, this song starts, and it has this lovely kind of piano very tinkly kind of gentle, and it's like this moment of relief for the audience, because the audience is going ape shit because James Bond just freaking skied off of a cliff with a parachute. On YouTube there's a wonderful like 12 to 15 minute documentary about that stunt. Check it out. The actual stuntman, the guy that said I can do this, and he did it. It's brilliant. And apparently two cameras failed. They only had one camera working that caught the whole thing, and it's great. And it goes into this song, Nobody Does It Better. Now, there's a grammar issue in this song. Nobody does it half as good as you. But Carol Bayer Sager said, I know that that's not correct. I knew, having taught English, that half as good as you was not proper grammar. But writing nobody does it half as well as you, which is correct, sounded terrible to my ear. Many times in writing songs, I made grammatically incorrect choices because certain words just sang better and sounded better to me than others. I completely concur. It wouldn't be nearly as cool if it was nobody does it half as well as you. Yeah. So Nobody Does It Better from 1977, Carly Simon. I just love this tune. I think it's just so cool. Essentially.
Major, minor, one.
And then later on, there's this, like heaven above me, major to minor, E with a third of the bass, with major to minor. It's a very simple motion, but boy, it's really effective. Doesn't have some of the Bond tropes, but there's this implied thing because of your major minor chords that are switching back and forth. It's really, really fun. Really, really love it. Nobody does it half as good as you. Finally, we get to my favorite James Bond song. This is my favorite because I think it incorporates... It's on guitar. This, for a number of reasons. First off, it incorporates a number of the Bond tropes in the best way. Let's go over here, actually. Don't forget you can donate at Venmo and PayPal if you enjoy this. Please leave a comment. Subscribe and like the thing as well. Do a thumbs up at some point if you possibly can. It's very simple, but just do it and it helps. So they rebooted the whole shebang here with Casino Royale in 2006 when the Bond's name, who escapes me, the current Bond, Daniel Craig. When Daniel Craig took over the role in 2006, it was kind of a reboot. They made him young again. It started before he had his 00 license, and Chris Cornell from Soundgarden wrote this wonderful song, It right away has the... starts with those kind of James Bond chords. The major, major, a third away from each other. The reason, though, that I think I really love this tune, and the reason that it stuck with me all these years and has become my favorite, first of all, Chris Cornell is just a monster. He's just an absolute monster. He gets across the James Bond kind of ethos within this tune. He sings the crap out of it. But I saw this film at the second week it was out in London. Ms. Info and I actually were in London, and we thought, oh, let's go see the new James Bond reboot. So we went to a theater.
Leicester Square.
That's right, Leicester Square. We realized that, oh my gosh, English theaters, cinemas, give you assigned seating. Like you have a ticket with your seat number. Like, what the hell is that about?
So classy.
It's kind of cool. So classy, yeah. So we went, and you know, the opening sequence to this film happens. It's all in black and white. Basically, Bond kills his first kill. He gets his 00 license by killing the first guy. And then this tune starts, and it was a wonderful animated sequence that happens as well. It's like computer animation, but it's one of the first times in a James Bond movie that the computer animation isn't trying to look like computer animation or isn't trying to look realistic. It's all like cards. It's all about casino and cards and roulette. And it's a wonderfully stylish and stylized opening over this crazy tune that Chris Cornell has written, who's singing just the crap out of it. What was astonishing is this is the first James Bond song that wasn't on the James Bond soundtrack. Part of the deal Chris Cornell said was, I want this on my solo album, which is coming out like a year after the James Bond movie. So I went and bought the James Bond soundtrack thinking it would have this on it, and it wasn't on there. I'm like, how is that even, what? So then I bought the Chris Cornell record, which was fantastic, and it was on there. But I had to wait like an extra little bit of time. So this, again, is sort of my favorite. He does this lovely thing where he goes between B minor and G major. But then he goes to B minor and G minor. And it totally changes the character. So the intro chords, B minor, G, E. But then in the verse, instead of playing a G major, he plays a G minor. And it gives you this lovely, suspenseful, again, major minor thing, just like the Carly Simon song. If you take a life, do you know what you get? Because if it was get, it wouldn't be nearly as cool. If you take a life, do you know what you get? No. Get the minor. That's what you want. You want that suspenseful kind of James Bond thing. You don't know what's going to happen. This is drama. So this is my favorite James Bond song from the 2006 movie Casino Royale. You Know My Name. If you take a life, do you know what you give? Odds you won't like what it is. When the storm arrives, would you be seen with me by the merciless eyes of deceit? I've seen angels fall from blinding heights, but you yourself are nothing so divine. Just next in line. Inside, things will not be the same when you return to the night. If you think you've won, you never saw me change the game we've all been playing. Well, I've seen diamonds cut through harder men than you yourself. But if you must pretend, your end. Arm yourself, because no one else here will save you. The veins, you know my name.
It's so much fun. And I get to do this thanks to my dad years ago, who taught me how to tie a bow tie. He said it's essential that you, after the gig, you do that. That's essential. It's essential. Thank you for tuning in. That's seven songs. Thanks for sticking around. Thanks for making it through the delay. Not delay, but the pause. Things got very busy between Music Fest and all kinds of stuff. Don't forget, I do have a podcast. The Geologic Podcast is available weekly from geologicpodcast.com. Please tune in over there. Like I said, go like this thing, subscribe to this thing. If you can throw some shekels over there into Venmo or PayPal, that makes all of these kinds of programs possible. Take care of yourselves. Stay safe. And I got a big race on Sunday, so I'll see you on the other side of it. Wish me luck. Wish me luck. Thanks, everybody. Thanks to Ms. Info, as always. Thanks to all of you. Stay safe. Good night. Bye, everybody.